So let's start our topic today. So I'm Neeta Patil, working as a senior accessibility QA engineer here in DevExpert. But my journey in accessibility started around 11 years ago. So let me tell you quickly and shortly how I got introduced to this field. So in India, there is one university where they teach advanced technology like computer and mobile devices to the people who are visually impaired. And they wanted their website to be accessible, and they hired few developers, so I including me. And that's how I started as a developer, and then I switched to consultation and then testing. In my journey, I have completed, you know, various certification, including IAP. I'm certified professional in web accessibility. I have also completed CPACC, AWS, then DHS Trusted Tester certification. So in this certification, I have learned how the accessibility work in physical world, how it works in academic curriculum, and then how it works in digital world. This is about my professional journey. Personally, I'm spiritual. I believe in principle of karmas. What goes around comes around. And I practice yoga to keep my mind healthy and my body flexible. And this is me doing the famous dancer pose. So what we are discussing today, first we will discuss some introductory part, then we will know the answer of all why accessibility is important. Then we will discuss the type of disability, how the people interact with the digital content. Then we will see the web content accessibility guidelines. Then there are some laws. We will see the legal aspect of accessibility. Then actually we will see where and how you can start accessibility in your project. And then we will see some live example, which we faced, which you might face. So I'm sure every one of you must have seen accessibility in the physical world. As you can see in the picture, we have ramps, we have braille display, we have bumpy roads to guide the people. So the people maybe and the government are continuously working to make everyone's lives easy and to make them feel independent. But when the same people visit digital world, sometimes they feel neglected and dependent on their maybe family and friends and the people around them just to, you know, fill a simple form or maybe just to make a bank transaction or just to shop online. So digital accessibility is about making sure that your content is accessible and usable by everyone. Now let's see some importance. So as per WHO, 16% of world population have some kind of disabilities. So if we are making our content accessible, that means we are attracting the 16% of world population, as you can see in the graph. So we can increase our customer base, we can increase our audience. At the same time, it shows that we care about people, we care about equal opportunities to everyone. And it also improves your brand reputation and it acts as a differentiator amongst your competitors. Then it also reduces the legal risk and FT fines. We will see the laws later in the session. And on top of everything, it makes life easier and help everyone to contribute to the society. So let me tell you an example of the famous physicist, Dr. Stephen Hawking. So his whole body was paralyzed, only his stick muscle was working and he could blink with the eye. With these two things and with the technology, he could discover so many theories. Those theories we're using now. So having disability should not, you know, exclude people from discovery, from following their passion. And there is a hidden benefit of accessibility that it improves your search engine optimization as well. So both accessibility and SEO focuses on well-structured, well-organized, and easy-to-understand content. Then last but not least, we all will grow old one day. So if we start accessibility from today, then we can give this to our future selves. It will help us in our latter phase of life. So these are some importance of accessibility. Let's see the type of disability. Let me ask you a simple question. Trust me, it's really simple. How many senses we have in our body using which we interact with the world around us? Five? Yeah, that's the right one. Thank you. So right now, there is nothing on the internet which we can smell and taste. So we will not talk about those senses. We have our eyes, ear, and the touch, using which we interact. So digital accessibility, you know, says that we have to provide the content to one of our senses. Then there are four major categories of disability: visual, related to the sense of sight; auditory, related to the sense of hearing; motor disabilities are related to the body movement; then cognitive neurological are related to how someone's brains work; then the fifth one is a temporary, the situational one. So disabilities with aging, as the people age, they might face some kind of disability, which we have listed above. Injuries, like if we made an accident, then we might fracture our hands, so we are restricted to make certain body movement. If we lost our glasses, then we might see but not clearly, so we need to take the help of some softwares, like Zoom feature is there. Let's see how the people interact with the digital content. So there are assistive technologies. So it is any device, any equipment, or any software which support and expand someone's digital experience. So it helps them to complete their day-to-day activities. So let's see, the first category is visual. First type of disability is blindness. If a person is not able to see anything, then how they interact? So there are softwares as a screen readers. They can use the screen reader which convert text into a synthesized speech. So if their this sense is not working, so they can take the help of their this sense. There are so many screen readers in market, but widely used are JAWS and NVDA for Windows, then VoiceOver and TalkBack for mobile devices. So those are the inbuilt screen readers. Color blindness is if some people are not able to see some color or certain combination of color. So there are some examples. Red blind means if a person is not able to see red color or any combination of red, similar way blue blind and green blind. Then the complete color blindness means a person is not able to see any color. For them, everything is grayscale, black and white. Then low vision people, they can see, but they are not able to see clearly. So they use screen magnifiers as assistive technology, which can help them to zoom the page and focus on the area where they can see clearly. Let's move to the next category, is auditory. If their this sense is not working, then they have to use their this sense. So if you have any content in audio, video, then how they can perceive it? So we have to provide captions, transcript, or sign language. Then there are people who cannot see and who cannot hear anything. For them, they can use the refreshable braille display. As you can see in the picture, similar like a screen reader, there are software which convert text into a refreshable braille. So they can use their this sense of touch, and that's how they perceive the content. Then motor disability is related to the body movement. So the people can read the content using one of the senses, but they're not able to operate or interact with the content. So people can use the assistive technology, as you can see in the images. First one is a mouth stick. So they can put the mouth stick into a mouth, and they, with the help of the head movement, they can point on the screen maybe, or they can use a keyboard. In similar way, they can use a head pointer. Then there are one-handed keyboard as well. Then trackball mouse is there. So mostly the people who are the oldish people, they are not able to precisely point on the screen using the regular mouse. They can use the trackball mouse. Then there are voice recognition software as well. As we have smartphone, how the Siri and Google Assistant work. In similar way, we can install the software in our system, and we can interact with the content using the voice command. Then disabilities related to the brain, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. So people find it's difficulty to focus on one activity. They easily get distracted. Then learning disabilities is related to how someone understand the things, how much time they need to process the data. Memory impairment is related to how someone remember the things. And then dyslexia is the people are not able to differentiate between the similar letters. We can see with the help of this simulator, you can see how it works. As you can see, all letters are changing their places. So even if you want to read one word, as you can see how it is difficult to read at least one word here. So that's all about the type of disability. Now, as a tester, as an organization, how we will make sure that our content is accessible? So we have web content accessibility guidelines, which was created by World Wide Web Consortium and is considered one of the international stable and referenceable standards. So if you are here or maybe you're in USA, Canada, you can refer these guidelines to make your content accessible. There are major four principles under this guidelines: perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust. So perceivable, as we have seen, content should be perceivable to one of our senses. Operable means the content should be operable. Understandable, it is easy to understand. Robust, the content should be robust enough to accommodate the wide variety of assistive technology, the softwares, and the browser. Under these four principles, we have 13 guidelines. Under these 13 guidelines, we have 86 testable surface criteria. So as a tester, we can consider those as a test cases. We can pass and fail those. These success criteria are further divided into three levels: level A, AA, and AAA. So in level A, we focus mostly on the basic requirement. Then in level AA, some mid-range requirement. And in AAA, we focused on the advanced level. So as per law, we have to comply till level AA. This is about WCAG guidelines. Let's see some laws. So if your content is available to public, then there are certain laws that we have to comply. And each and every country have their own laws. We will see some here. So in America, we have the Americans with Disability Act. If you have any private business and your content is available to public, then you have to comply with this law. If you are a government agency and if you are providing any services or any product to the government, then we have to comply to Section 508 law. Then in Canada, we have Accessibility for Ontarians with Disability Act. In Europe, we have European Accessibility Act. So as per EAA, we have to comply till 2030. So still we have a few years to learn about accessibility. Now how and where you can start accessibility in your project. So accessibility is not an afterthought. We have to start accessibility from the very early phase of development, software development life cycle. It really saves your time and money. So how we do it here in DevXpert? So we usually do it from the design phase. We review the designs. We mostly address the color and design related issue in design phase. Then in development phase, we do the pull request review. So we focus mostly on the coding related issue here. And then in testing phase, we actually perform the testing with the help of some automated tools and manually. So how we do it here, we use XDEM tool. It's a extension to the browser. So you can simply add this extension and you can scan your page. Then Lighthouse, it's an inbuilt Chrome extension. Then Accessibility Scanner is an Android app. Then if you have a MacBook, you can install Xcode, and then there you will find this Accessibility Inspector option. So you can scan your page, your content using these automated tools. So as per our experience, it will at least cover 30-40% of the issues. For rest of the issues, we manually have to check. So how we do it here? So in step one, we perform everything with the help of keyboard only. So we have to check if the user is able to interact and operate a content only using keyboard or not. Then in step two, we do the color contrast review. So as you can see in the screenshot, there is a color contrast analyzer tool. So you can pick the foreground color, background color. It will show you the ratio here, as you can see. And then it will also show you that which success criteria it is failing as per WCAG. Usually we skip this step. Why? Because we do it in the design phase. In step three, we do the testing with screen magnifiers. So right now we are using browser zoom. You can simply press the control plus till 200%. That is the requirement from WCAG. And you need to check if your content is scaling uniformly or not. You can also use the system zoom, as you can see in the screenshot. Then in step four, we perform the testing with screen reader. So JAWS is a licensed version, so we use NVIDIA here. It is free, you can easily install it. VoiceOver is an inbuilt screen reader, as you can see in the screenshot. It's a screenshot of iPhone setting. You can, if you have a smartphone, you can go to setting, you will find this accessibility section, and under this section, you will find all the necessary settings which is required for testing. Then in step five, we check all the success criteria from WCAG level AA. So this is really important step, because this will really help you to check the percentage of your website, how much your website is conforming to the WCAG. So this is really important. This report, when we create a conformance report, that report we can show to the client, or we can show to the government. And then let's see some example that we faced here, or maybe you will face it. So let's see the first example of semantic markup. If your semantic markup is not correct, then how the screen reader will read this simple form? There is a login form. I will play the audio, you can also.
Edit has auto complete blank. Edit protected blank. Checkbox not checked. Forgot password. Button.
As you can see, it is not reading in label. It just say edit for both the, a text box. The label are not provided. Then for forget password, it does not say it is a link. So role is not provided. For login button, it's not announcing its label. Now let's see the accessible example, how it will read.
Username edit required has auto complete blank. Password edit protected required blank. Remember username checkbox not checked. Forgot password link. Login button.
As you can see, it is reading the label correctly. Then it is also announcing the role. Like it says forgot password link. Now, if we make it accessible, the people who are using screen reader can easily fill this simple form. Okay. So we have to make sure that our semantic markup is correct, and whatever the information we are presenting visually is also available programmatically as well. So screen reader can read it. Let's see the second example of images. If the this image is inaccessible, if the label is not provided, then how the screen reader will read this label or this image?
Unlabeled graphic to get missing image descriptions. Open the context menu.
So as you can see, screen reader is just announcing unlabeled graphics. So in browser, we have this feature that detect the image description automatically, but it is not correct sometime. If let's see how it will announce if we provide the alternative text.
Graphic DX trade logo.
So it says graphics DX trade logos. Graphics is the role of that element like image, and then it says DX trade logo. It's the label. So we have to make sure that if we have informative images in our content, we have to provide the alternative text. If we are using the images only for decoration, then we have to make sure that the screen reader is not reading them. Let's see the another example related to colors. As you can see in the screenshot, we are using green and red color to show the upstream and downstream, or maybe loss and profit. How the people who have read blind will see the same content? As you can see, they will not be able to identify which is up trending and which is down trending. So what solution we have provided? We have provided the icons along with the colors. Okay, so as you can see, even if user is not able to perceive any color, they can still understand what is up trending and what is down trending. So I'll give you one tip here. You can check your content in a grayscale, black and white. So that's how you will get to know, is your content still make any sense if you see it in the black and white colors. Then there is another example related to colors. If your CCA ratio is poor, as you can see, the ratio for your password and login is less than 4.5:1. That is a requirement from WCAG. So how it will look when we increase the ratio? Now the ratio is more than 4.5:1. Another problem we face related to Zoom, when user are using screen magnifier, when they zoom till 200%, sometimes the text get truncated and overlapped on each other. So we have to make sure that our content is scaling uniformly. Then if you have any audio or video content, and if there is no captions, no transcript, or no sign language provided, then that we consider as an inaccessible content. So as you can see in the screenshot, we have to provide the captions and the transcript. So this can really help everyone. Now I'm learning Portuguese. So if I see any video in Portuguese and if the caption is not there, then I really find it difficult to understand. And this transcript also, you know, if there is a video which does not have audio in your language, maybe there is no caption. And if it has transcript, you can simply copy the transcript and paste it into the translator. And that's how you can, you know the content about this video. And this transcript also helps the people who are using refreshable braille display. They cannot convert the caption, but they can convert the transcript text. So these are some examples. Now, some tips, what do's and don'ts we all can follow. So avoid using any long passages of text, as we have seen how it is, how difficult it is for people who have dyslexia to read the content. So we can use some images, icon, graphs along with the text. Then avoid using any complex structure and content that are difficult to understand. So suppose there is a lengthy registration form. So instead of having only one form, we can split that form into a step. So user can complete one step at a time. Then avoid using anything which is continuously moving, blinking, or flickering in your content, because the people who have ADHD find it very difficult to, you know, focus on the main activity of your content. They will get easily distracted. Or if you have provided, then make sure that you have provided play and pause button as well along with that content. Then do not restrict user to change the text styling. So sometimes the user can use some extension to the browser where they can change the space between, you know, two letters, space between two words, so they can easily read it. Then use autofill option for fonts. So if we provide this option, the user who have any kind of memory impairment, they can use this option, like autofill option will help them to fill their email address, their address, you know, their phone number easily. They no need to remember it every time. What are our takeaway from this section? So digital accessibility is not just about compliance. We have to make sure that it is accessible to everyone. So sometimes it happens that your content is compliant as per the WCAG, but it is still inaccessible to the end user. So we have to gather some feedback from the user, and that's how we can improve our content. Then prioritize user experience by designing with accessibility in mind from the start. So this small change can, you know, have a significant difference. Then automated testing tools helps, but they are not substitute for manual testing. So this is a debate everywhere. So automated tool, as we already discussed, it can help you to detect 30-40% issues, but still we have to check manually as well. So just to give an example, automated tool can detect if your image have alt text or not, but if that alt text is correct or meaningful, you manually have to check it. Then educate everyone. So spread the awareness about accessibility as much as possible in your organization, in your community. That's how we can build a habit. That's how we can build a culture. So together as a community, we can make the, you know, digital world a better place for everyone. And this is a gift from me to my community. You can scan the QR code and you will get all the helpful links so that you can start your journey, accessibility testing. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you so much.